the night of the Lord's trials. You'll remember that Peter was accused of being with the Lord. And of course, it was on this occasion that he denied even knowing the Lord. He denied him three times. But in the process of those denials, one of the things that his accuser said to him was, "Thy speech bewrayeth thee." The word that you and I would probably use is the word betray. Your speech betrays you. But if you look into the American Standard Version, the wording is, "Thy speech maketh thee known." Peter was a Galilean. And so the speech that he used, the language that he used, enabled those who were listening to him, those who were present, it enabled them to know that obviously he was not one of them. And it also led them to believe that he was one of the followers of Jesus. The Lord said in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 34, "Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh." And when we understand what the Lord was saying, we know that the language that we use as the Lord's followers, as his disciples, reveals much about us as individuals. It reveals our hearts. It reveals the kind of people that we are. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 4 verse 8, "Whatsoever things are true, honest, just, lovely, a good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things." In other words, fill your minds with those things that are good and honest and pure. Then those things will also be seen in your speech, and it will also be seen even in your actions. One of the interesting things that you can do to even come to a better understanding of the importance of language and what it does reveal is to look at a number of examples in the Old Testament as well as the New, and the things that these individuals said revealed a great deal about them. Even though in some of those occasions, on some of those occasions, they only spoke a few words that revealed a great deal about their hearts. Let's look at a number of examples that we read about in the Scriptures. First of all, there is Abraham. Abraham once made the statement to the Lord, "I am but dust and ashes. I am but dust and ashes." Now, to get into our minds the background of this, your text would be Genesis, the 18th chapter. Abraham was sitting in the door of his tent in the heat of the day. And he looked up, and there were three men who were approaching him. One thing that makes this interesting is two of these men were angels. One of them is identified as the Lord, who was on this occasion in human form. And so these three men approached Abraham's tent. He rose up and he went to meet them, to bring them onto his tent. And obviously there was something, and the text indicates this, there was something about one of those men that enabled Abraham to know that he was the Lord. Now we know that a part of it was some of the things that the Lord said. But Abraham was very, very humble. He showed them hospitality by inviting them to sit up under a tree and to allow him to fetch a morsel of bread and to give them food and drink before they went on their way. The men allowed him to do so he went into Sarah and told her what they needed to do in order to provide that hospitality, to bake the bread so that the men would have something to eat. He goes back out to them. They spend time together, and then after a while, the men rise up and they're ready to leave. Abraham, and this was a part of the hospitality of the day, Abraham began to walk with them. And his intent was to walk a certain way, a certain part of the way with them as they left his tent, as they left that area where he was living at the time. Now, at this particular point in time, we read in Genesis chapter 18, verse 19, of the Lord's estimation of this good man named Abraham. One of the interesting things about this is that Abraham was walking along with those three men, two of them angels, the third one being the Lord himself in human form. And it appears that the Lord was speaking, likely, to the other two angels as they were walking together. And the Lord asked, "Shall I hide that thing from Abraham, which I do, seeing that he will make a great nation of people, and his name will be great?" And then the Lord said, "For I know him." Now, if you look in the text, the Lord was not speaking directly to Abraham, which leads us to believe he was likely speaking to the two angels. But Abraham was walking along with them and heard what the Lord was saying about him. So the Lord said, "I know him. I know Abraham, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he had spoken of him." And then at that point, the Lord begins to inform Abraham of his intention to destroy the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah because of their exceeding wickedness. Abraham, of course, in the knowledge that he has relatives living there, Lot and his family, Abraham begins to intercede on behalf of Lot and the other inhabitants of Sodom. And so he begins by saying, "If you find 50 righteous people, will you destroy the city, the wicked, along with those who are righteous?" And the Lord said, "No. No, if I find 50 righteous, I will spare the city for the sake of those 50. And then, when Abraham continues to speak, this is what he says: "Behold now, I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord, which am but dust and ashes." Abraham was well aware of the fact that he was standing before the Lord. And he understood that as he stood before the Lord himself, that he was simply a creature of dust. That he was simply a creature of dust and ashes. And he understood that it was the Lord himself who had made man. Going back to the second chapter of the book of Genesis, and Genesis 1, 26 and 27, going into chapter 2. And so he was well aware of his unworthiness to even stand before the Lord. And he knew that he was unworthy even to continue to speak to the Lord on behalf of those whom he wanted spared and was hoping to be spared from the impending destruction. Now you'll remember that in the text, the two angels, before this conversation began, looked toward Sodom, and then they began walking in that direction to carry out the mandate of the Lord. But here on this occasion, Abraham knew that he owed his very existence to the one to whom he was speaking. It's amazing. An amazing statement. And then there is Job. Job once made the statement, "I am vile." It's interesting to look at Job. He was a good man. He was referred to in Job chapter 1, referred to by the Lord as a perfect man. Now that word perfect does not mean sinless, but it simply means complete, spiritually complete or spiritually mature. He was one who kept the commandments of God. He was one who was faithful to God. He was one who raised his children in the way that the Lord would have him do. And his children, his entire family, were good people. And the Lord had blessed him greatly. As a matter of fact, we see the Lord's estimation of him when God himself is speaking to the devil in Job chapter 1 and verse 8. The Lord said, "Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God, and escheweth," or avoids, "evil? Have you considered Job, this good man, this upright man?" My, oh my. What a compliment. What greater compliment could be paid to an individual in
and even then by the Lord himself. Yes, Job was a good man. He was a righteous man. Job was going to go through the furnace of adversity. If you keep reading through the end of chapter 1 and on into chapter 2, you'll find that Job, in the conversation between God and the devil, Satan accuses God of putting a hedge around Job. And in essence, the devil was saying to the Lord, yes, he's going to be faithful to you if you're protecting him. If you bless him to the degree that you blessed him, of course he's going to be faithful to you. But if you remove that hedge, if you take it away, and you allow him to be afflicted, and you allow him to suffer, he'll curse you to your face. Well, the Lord had confidence in Job. The Lord had confidence in him. And he allowed Satan to take away everything that he had. And so then, in rapid succession, one right after the other, he lost his material possessions. He lost his flocks and his herds. Then he lost his children. All of his children were killed in a single day. Job was devastated. He was devastated. And then the Lord allowed the devil to physically afflict Job. And so Satan's statement to the Lord was, if you allow me to afflict his flesh, to touch his flesh, then he'll curse you to your face. God said, go ahead and do it. You can touch his flesh, but you cannot take his life. You cannot kill him. And so Job was afflicted with sores, with boils from the crown of his head all the way to the soles of his feet. He was in bad shape. He was in a miserable condition. His friends come along, and they began to accuse him of being a sinner. And so Job maintains his integrity and his innocence, even before his own friends. And of course, if you have friends like that, you certainly don't need enemies. But they accused him of being a sinner in the sight of God. Job, in essence, said, no, I am not a sinner in the sight of God. That is, in the sense that I have brought these things upon myself. He maintained his innocence. He maintained his integrity. And that is what he did before his friends. But in the presence of a holy God, Job looked at himself and he said, I am vile. Now, in the context of what you're reading here in chapter 40, in chapter 39, Job, although he did maintain his innocence and his integrity, he did begin to question God as to why these things were happening to him. And then in chapter 40, God answered Job out of that whirlwind. And so God, in essence, tells Job, you sit up like a man. I'm going to speak to you, and now you're going to answer me. I'm going to ask you questions, and you're going to give me the answer. And then as God begins to ask these questions, Job truly recognizes what he is in the sight of God. He recognizes his own sense of unworthiness, and he says to the Lord, I am vile. I am vile. What shall I answer thee? Look at what he says. I will lay my hand upon my mouth. I've spoken once, but I will not answer. I've spoken twice, but I will proceed no further. Job recognized his own status before a holy and a just God. That's one of the reasons that he stood approved in God's sight. And then there's Ezra. Ezra once made the statement, I blush to lift up my face. Ezra is one of the outstanding characters that you read about in the Old Testament. He wrote one of the Old Testament books. Ezra was not a prophet. He was a priest. But Ezra worked alongside men like Nehemiah and others to restore the people of Israel to the land from which they had been taken. There was a lot going on during that period of time. A lot of things that were not good at all that were beginning to take place.
the Israelite people were beginning to mix among the nations around them. They were mingling with and intermarrying with pagans. They were beginning to adopt their ways of life. Many of the Israelite people were beginning to go off into paganism. And Ezra was very displeased over that, and he was very discouraged over that. And as a matter of fact, if you read the account, as we find it in Ezra chapter 9, Ezra sees their sins as piling up, even to the gates of heaven. This is one of the things that we read in that chapter. This is just 4 through 6. Then were assembled unto me every one that trembleth at the words of the God of Israel, because of the transgression of those that had been carried away. And I sat astonished, simply means astonished or amazed, until the evening sacrifice. You see, Ezra was ashamed, not of his own sins, because he was striving to please God, and he was striving to be the kind of leader that those people needed him to be. So he was astonished at their sins. And he was ashamed, and he recognized that there was a great blemish upon the people of God because of their conduct and because of what they were doing. He says in verse 5, and at the evening sacrifice, I rose from my heaviness. Heaviness here simply means fasting. He had been fasting and praying, as you read there in chapter 9. And at the time of the evening sacrifice, he arose from that fasting and prayer, that period of fasting and prayer. He says, I rent my garment, I tore my garment and my mantle. I fell upon my knees and spread out my hands unto the Lord my God. And I said, oh my God, I am ashamed and blush to lift up my face to thee, my God. For our iniquities are increased over our head, and our trespass is grown up into the heavens. It's a bad time. For Ezra remained faithful to God, and he continued striving to be the kind of leader that God wanted him to be. But he was ashamed, and he recognized that sin brings shame. That sin had shamed God's own people. And he said, I blush to appear before God. You can call that the language of humility. And then there's Isaiah. I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips. Isaiah was one of the great prophets of the Old Testament period. Isaiah was practically fearless as a worker for God, as a prophet of Almighty God. He was the one chosen to present and to deliver the messianic prophecies of which we read in Isaiah chapter 53. We also find that Isaiah prophesied to a people who oftentimes were hard-headed and hard-hearted. And he wrote about that in Isaiah chapter 5. You go over one chapter, you'll find there that, of course, Isaiah lived during the time of King Uzziah. As a matter of fact, he was even a friend of King Uzziah. And we read that during that time that Isaiah was privileged to see a vision of God on the throne. You can only imagine how that humbled this great prophet of God. Look at what he had to say. In that year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Now that's just verse 1. If you continue to read, you'll find that smoke is filling the area, much like existed on Mount Sinai when God's presence was located on the top of that mountain. And there was thick, black smoke, and there was thunder, and there was lightning, and the entire mountain was quaking, was shaking at the very presence of God. And that when God spoke, it sounded like majestic thunder. And the people were terrified, and they begged Moses to intercede for them to entreat the Lord not to speak to them anymore, but for God to speak through Moses. That's how terrified they were of God and of that great majestic scene. And even here in the first few verses of Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah says that when the one sitting upon the throne began to speak, that the post began to shake. It was a majestic scene. And from there, you go just a few verses later, in Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 3, and the prophet refers to the seraphim, which is a rank of angels. He says the seraphim were surrounding the throne of God, His majestic throne, and they cried one to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory." Imagine, if you can, Isaiah beholding that majestic scene. How do you suppose he would react? What do you suppose his attitude would be? This is it. "Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." I am undone. I am cut off. That was how he recognized himself as he is seeing this vision of God sitting upon the throne. The language of humility. And then finally, there's Peter. Peter, one of the great men of the New Testament, one of the Lord's apostles, a great leader in the church, very courageous up until the end. And of course, it was at that time during the Lord's trials that Peter lost that courage, that faith, at least for a while, and he denied even knowing the Lord. But he was going to change. And Jesus Christ knew that he was going to change, because Jesus told him earlier, "When you're converted, strengthen your brethren." That's exactly what he did. He proved to be a source of strength for his fellow Christians, even for his fellow apostles, and he proved to be a great pillar in the early church. But we read about something that he said at the beginning of the Lord's ministry. Peter and his associates were fishing. They had fished all night, and they didn't catch anything. And then they saw the Lord. They saw the Lord the next morning. And Jesus told Peter, to move out away from the shore and to cast your nets again into the water. Peter reminded him. He said, "Lord, we fished all night and we haven't caught anything." But he said, "At your word, we will cast out the nets." And he obeyed the Lord. He did as the Lord instructed him to do. They rowed out away from the shore, and he dropped his nets. They dropped their nets into the water and began to pull them back into the boat. And the nets were full of fish. And as a matter of fact, the nets were so full that the nets themselves began to break. Peter and his associates began to motion to their associates, their fellow workers in the other boats, to come over and to help them. And so they began to go over to the boat to help Peter and the other workers pull the nets into the boats. And of course, Peter knew that nothing short of a miracle had just taken place. And he knew that it was because of the Lord's word that that miracle had just happened. This is what Peter said. He fell down at Jesus' knees, and he said, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." Peter understood at that moment that he was in the presence of deity. And you can see in this statement his sense of unworthiness. You can see his sense of humility as he's standing before the Lord. And as he bows down before him, he tells Jesus, Lord, depart from me, leave me, because I am a sinful man. The language of humility. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, expects no less from us. That is to be humble, to have an attitude of humility. And it requires humility to be obedient to the Lord. It requires humility to even live for the Lord. And this is the reason. Because we submit our will to His will. We bow our will to His. We see this displayed on Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. Many of the people who called out for the Lord's crucifixion were hearing the gospel now for the very first time. And they were pricked in their heart, Acts 2 and 37. And they asked the question, what shall we do? Wouldn't you say that required humility? Tell us what to do. Peter gave the instructions in verse 38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Then they that gladly received His word were baptized, Acts 2:41. That required humility. We've been told what to do, so now we're going to do it. We're going to obey. And then to live the Christ-like life requires that we have humility. It requires that we have the attitude of, speak, Lord, thy servant heareth. A statement that Isaiah once made. Have that attitude. In Romans 12 and verse 1, Paul said, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That requires humility. In the words of Peter in 1 Peter 5 and 6, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He might exalt in due time. There may be someone here who's yet outside of Christ, and so your need then is to become a New Testament Christian, a child of God. We encourage you to do that through obedience to the gospel. And it begins with humility. It begins with the attitude of, I want to do what the Lord wants me to do. I want to obey Him. I want to do what He instructs me to do through His word. Of course, you have the instructions in Acts 2:38 that we mentioned a moment ago. Maybe someone here is an unfaithful child of God. Maybe sin in your life. It requires humility to turn away from sin. It requires the attitude of mind. I don't want to live this life anymore. I want to please the Lord. I want to live the kind of life that would honor and glorify Him, that would bring praise to His name. And then to turn away from it in repentance and pray. You're subject to heaven's invitation. Come to